with your group, do you listen to many albums?
Yeah, of course.
And be really honest. I mean, like, are there any artists that have been around, that are established, that you do still like?
Well, not really, actually. I like what they have done in the past, right?
Right.
I don't find a lot of the older people, older rock and roll people, very stimulating anymore. You know, I like Gene Vincent, right? Like Eddie Cochran, when they did it, or when it's great. You know, I like sort of the little piece of 3 minutes, which is like encapsulated on records.
Yeah.
I like things like that, but you know, I like a lot of the Beatles stuff. I love, like I said, like I already said, like "Woman Is the Nigger of the World." Yeah. I think that's great. That John Lennon wrote 70s music before we got here today. He wrote punk rock. You know, his early songs, like I mean, "Cold Turkey" is the most simplest thing you've ever heard if you listen.
Yeah.
So I have got people I like, but the thing is, they let me down. They let me down because they either stopped making great rock and roll, or the songs they started to write started to have no bearing on my life, so they became irrelevant for me.
Right.
And like today, I don't have nobody like that.
Yeah.
I listen back on what I used to like and feel, you know, but now I'm making music for myself. We've got all these great influences from the 60s, you know, like I think the Beatles, the Who, the Kinks, and then there's a lot of American people, you know, like Stooges and stuff, all that sort of people.
Yeah.
Even like the old rock and roll, like Gene Vincent, right? We've got all those influences that show you what's right about rock and roll, right? And now we want to go on, take the next step and push rock and roll another step further, right?
Right.
You know, still encapsulate all that's gone before, but move on. Just about wanting to make a next step, right? And just saying what's happened in the past 6 years and wanting to move on, you know?
Mm.
And whatever it takes, it might take violence, you know? It might take hatred, it might take love again, I don't know. But we're gonna like try and find out, try and push.
Well, punk didn't change the world, but it did change the face of music for a while. Like everything else, though, in time the movement had run its course. And after 4 years together, so had Generation X.
The whole thing was just to really kick open our own front door. Wasn't even worrying about anywhere else in the world. He wasn't even thinking beyond London.
Yeah.
I don't think the time that everybody did things. It was really you were just thinking about kicking open the door wherever you were. Even with other musicians or other people or anything, it was just what was in front of you, the door that was in front of you.
Right.
It was always the next quest. Rather than thinking of any plan, I don't think anybody seriously thought of any sort of plan. But it's been exciting to see that so many musical things have happened. I think the worst thing, that it's got back to just like it was before punk, really. There's no doors being kicked open for anybody at the moment.
All right, now, okay, so with Generation X, did you take that seriously as a group? I mean, were you guys taking it seriously as it being a career?
Well, we never thought of it as a career at all. I mean, when punk rock first started, you didn't even think about getting a recording contract. It was the funniest thing in the world when the Sex Pistols got one. We just laughed.
Right.
And it was even funnier when we got one. But I mean, it still was serious about it. You know, still serious to us what we were doing. But it was more just the fun of doing it. It still is. We basically blasted into the music airwaves just on the fact that we'd gone and done it, and that there was nothing else around. And it was kind of a shock to find yourself then being in a position of really having to seriously come up with things. And so that became the next thing we had to do. And I think that's why punk rock groups were never the most stable things in the world, because they weren't really meant to last forever. They're only meant to last for the time that they could satisfy what they needed to do. And that was really just mainly blast into the music industry and give everybody a good kick up the arse. I mean, we wanted things to go on a long time, but we never planned it to. And a lot of the groups were built very fast, so that you really were only thinking of the moment you're actually doing it. It was like really live for today. Now, I'd learned a lot through being Generation X. I was writing a lot more of my own songs. It's just by the time Generation X was folding, we were no longer working as a unit where you really had the same...
It was folding.
Well, the group was just...
Or what?
Yeah, the whole thing was just collapsed. Well, the group had collapsed already, and we'd been through a huge lawyer-type thing that was so ridiculous that when we tried to put the group back together, it was never firing on the same cylinders. And that's something you always need. You need to renew things constantly. The thing was, for me to stay in England by that time, I mean, punk rock was something that was passé, not only in the newspapers, but even people's general sort of liking of music had drifted to the extent that they didn't even really remember any punk rock groups anymore. And the other thing was, I couldn't blame them. I mean, the basic thing was punk rock wasn't meant to last forever. And so in a way, it was my own, it was then my own search to find really people that I would seriously work with for a long time, but who would still help me explore my songwriting and still be in the type of musical environment I wanted to be in, not thrust in with a load of people who didn't care about me or wanted to play jazz or something.
As the 1980s began in Britain, Gen X called it quits, and the musical pendulum was swinging back to pop stars. Billy decided it was time for a change, and that change was a move to New York.
Was it scary for you to go from England to America, especially to New York? I mean, well, it's a pretty bold move by any means.
Yeah, well, it's difficult to find, it's hard to deal with a whole new culture, but the worse than that, I mean, I was really stepping outside of the nice microcosm world I already knew, which is all friendly, and whatever I would have been, I could have always lived as the X Generation Xer.
Yeah.
But I'd never have done anything else, and I'd never, certainly, I think, done anything to inspire anybody to be watching this today, so I'm glad I did it.
All right, so how did you go about, sort of, just, you hit New York, what do you do? I mean, like, there's a million people in New York looking for, you know, the same sort of goal.
Well, but I mean, I think you just hang out. That's really, that's what everything's like, a whole word of mouth process on everything. And you've just got to be there and hang out and get to know people and go for what you really want. It's difficult. It's not easy. I was going to have to sort of learn a whole new place. And I was sort of thrusting myself not only into the music world, but then to the actual city. And that I knew was going to be something that was sort of toughen me up and have to make me face reality and face what I was going to have to do.
It didn't take Billy long to get into the New York rock scene. He soon hooked up with guitarist Steve Stevens and reunited with producer Keith Forsey, who had worked on Gen X's last recording.
Thing was, in Generation X, I'd always worked with Tony James, who's basically a lyric writer who played bass. And the thing was, I was really writing my own lyrics a lot more and writing my own songs. I really needed someone who's a bit more musically involved than me. And it was just really hard to find someone, especially a guitarist in England, that I could really find that in. And it was only really hanging out in New York and stuff that gradually found out just how good Steve was through playing with him. Because that's what, I think that all best musical things happen from that sort of angle, that you just, you naturally meet people and find out how great they are. You don't just do it through adverts or things like that. So it was kind of eventually we actually got together and played. I think we were seriously both looking for a partnership, something that you could actually make last years. We're both looking for a group we'd be excited in, something new that we could start in New York.
Right.
It was just something fresh. There was a real emphasis on rhythm music there. And I was really tired with people who sang up in the stratosphere, you know. I thought it was great to hear somebody's voice down there, like, you know, a la Jim Morrison and Elvis, that really sort of cut through. The way it was mixed, you know, I just thought that was great. There was this big voice, so, you know, nice warm sound there, and I just thought, yeah, that sounds great. If only I could find a way, because at that time I thought there was a lot of exciting things happening technique-wise in guitar at that point, but there was nobody doing it within the context of a song. You had all the kind of Van Halen things, and people were learning how to play on the guitar with two hands and their feet and all that kind of stuff.
We're both looking for similar things. We like similar things that have both come out of New York and England. And I think we both wanted to put together the sort of punk rock musical world with the techno kind of disco musical world, be able to put dance music with serious rock and roll. And I think that wasn't really being tried so much in New York at the time, especially not rock and roll with dance music. And I think it's something that Steve and me both observed when we were in the clubs here, and I'd already started doing in London, so it was a natural thing. The one great thing that happened to me was that I'd found a producer in the form of Keith Forsey, someone no one had heard of, another secret weapon in my challenging the rock and roll establishment. And it was great to find someone who was English, but who'd worked with disco and rock and roll, and kind of, he knew that he wanted to work with a songwriter as well. And we'd done the last Generation X album, so it was something that I was continuing from my past. White wedding.
Billy teamed up with Keith and Steve for his self-titled debut album. The LP included Dancing With Myself, Hot in the City, and White Wedding, a song that caused as much controversy here in the States as Billy's punk days did back in Britain.
Well, the worst thing was people just getting the video all wrong and thinking it was some anti-women sort of women's lib thing or something, when really it was really trying to say that I think a lot of people, not only women, but a lot of people enter into things like marriage and stuff, just basically out of convention, a hope for happiness, a dream of it, almost like a drug. And I wasn't really putting down anybody, any sex in it. But a lot of women in that thought, because there was a bit of blood in the video and stuff, that it was directed as an anti-misogynist, a sort of misogynistic view of women, and it wasn't. And then there was another bit in it where people are reaching towards the people on the stage, so to speak, of this altar, and people were saying that there was Nazi salutes in it and it was all full of fascism, and it was incredible to see people sort of looking at everything about actually the reasons for the song, which was really a sort of aberration of people sort of putting themselves in a position looking for security and love and not finding it. I let you go for so
long, my wedding. Even though his first album made him a certifiable star in other parts of the world, here in America, Billy's success was still limited to dance clubs, but that was about to change. It was with his next LP, Rebel Yell, that things really exploded.
I mean, the thing was, it was only really through the videos. I mean, we spent all the time that we've been going, we've basically only got a certain amount of respect from certain different areas at all the points from that we've been playing. I mean, like I say, I think the biggest way our records got through the people was the dance chart, the dance halls and things, and then eventually getting out on tour. It was only really with Rebel Yell, the album, that people really started to take any notice in the States. Some place in the world, it was a lot different. Canada and places like that, and Australia and a few other places really got into things on a musical level just through the radio, but it wasn't like that here, and it was only really through trudging around America and slamming it home to them that you really, really actually got any sort of recognition whatsoever.
All of Billy's trudging around paid off. His 9.5-month tour established him as a major star, but the tour also took its toll, and when it was over, a performer who had been constantly making headlines suddenly seemed to drop out of sight.
We went from playing very small clubs to playing, you know, large venues in that one tour, and we weren't prepared to really go anywhere else. We didn't anticipate that record would do any, you know, as well as it did.
It just was necessary to take some time off to really get into a different attitude about things. I mean, we did Rebel Yell and went straight on the road, so when we finished after that, we were just zomboid, you know. Right. I couldn't even think of anything. It took us ages to even get back to normal. Like Steve used to wake up and spit on his wall thinking he was in a hotel and things like that. And so, I don't know, what I needed to do was really sort of just be able to sit back and even live with myself for a bit.
It was a 3-year gap between Rebel Yell and the new album Whiplash Smile. During that time, journalists got creative and all sorts of rumors and speculation abounded as to Billy's whereabouts. The truth was, Billy wanted to make sure his next album was a record he was happy with, and he was prepared to spend as much time as he needed to do just that.
I mean, that's one of the reasons we wanted to make albums with 10 good songs or 9 good songs. As in Rebel Yell's case, not one, you know, was that you could be proud of the whole thing. I mean, that's why I don't make millions and millions of albums, because I suppose we could do like 3 albums a year and you'd get two and a half songs on each and then a load of dross. And I think it's much more exciting for people to seriously go in there, especially real fans, and be able to buy something that's a totality, and then they don't have to worry about putting out another 7 something or other in the next 5 months for a load of rubbish. I think when we sort of disappeared in people's eyes after Rebel Yell, they get the feeling that you're not into being such a high publicity star, so you can't have the music behind you. I think what they're forgetting is that we've got the music behind us, so we don't have to be high publicity stars. Like that 1968 Elvis thing, you know, where he's in that square. So we kind of nicked that idea and put that into it, yeah. But I mean, I really just wanted to do a performance video, and it was exciting just to try and do it on a level but not make it live, you know.
about the new film clip, just tell us a little bit about it, the concept of it.
Well, I think it's really to show the sort of awful effects of violence on everybody, just the sort of amount of chaos it causes, and the fright and the fear and the harm on all sides, to anybody, to me or to anybody.
I suppose some people think it's a bit obvious, but I just think a song that's sort of anti-trite violence or stupidity is always worthwhile, and that's really what Don't Need a Gun's about. It's not so much just about guns, but it's more about just senseless violence. I mean, during the punk rock times, I saw a lot of really, really senseless violence happen almost right in front of your eyes. Like, once there was even, we were playing in Brighton, there was just two kids dancing, and there was hardly anybody in the place. But two guys just walked up to them and literally just broke bottles in their faces. And as far as I can see, people were only having fun. And it's that sort of thing which I've seen over all the years I've been alive, which makes you just sort of really just disgusted at things which have no real meaning. And it, living in America sometimes makes you realise just how something trite like that can go on.
Now, you're rehearsing in New York at the moment.
Yeah.
How many are going to be in the band?
Well, we've got Tommy Price on the drums, it's Kenny Aronson on the bass, Susie Davis, who was with Sheila E. and stuff on the keyboards, and Steve on guitar, and myself.
Right. Okay,
that's
now,
five.
So what can we expect as far as a live concert is concerned?
Pure rock and roll.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Full rock and roll?
Of course.
Goff, he looks set to have another big year. And even though Billy admits he's matured in the last few years, don't let anyone tell you he's mellowed.
There is a stigma in rock and roll about sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Terrible, isn't it? I think it's really great to think that at a time when most people were saying rock and roll is dead, to actually see it sort of alive is pretty exciting. I mean, it might smell funny. It ain't dead, it just smells funny, I mean.
Do you go out to shock people?
No. No, not at all. With this haircut, no. I've never thought about it. Do anything for my sweet 16. And I do everything for a little runaway teacher. Gave my heart an engagement ring. She took everything. Everything I gave her, oh sweet 16. Built a room for a rocking chair. I never guessed it would rock up my front.